everyone. Welcome to the Horror Room. I'm Travis Bruce, and today I'm doing another indie horror spotlight. I have with us today, this is a twisted man. This is a twisted man. He has a new movie out right now, streaming on Troma now. It's called Scream for Christmas. I have director Rob Avery. Rob, welcome to the Horror Room.
Hey, how's it going, man?
Pleasure, man. Glad to have you on, man. So
glad to be on the show, man. Thanks for inviting me on.
I came across your work with Slashers Gone Wild. So we're going to talk about it a little bit later, but let's talk about your new project right now, Scream for Christmas. Tell us a little bit about it.
Scream for Christmas. Well, it takes place like back in the 90s. You know, it's basically like a time capsule movie. And these teenagers, they're going to this building to have a Christmas party. And, you know, these cheerleaders, it's a cheerleader Christmas party. And, you know, they got their boyfriends with them. And it just so happens that at the party, you know, Rob the Slasher's on Christmas vacation. And so he's there. And then also there's a character. His name is Phil the Reaper. And he's got Grim Reaper powers. And then there's Muffy, the Kung Fu cheerleader. She's like one of the heroes. And then there's Betty. And she's also a murderous cheerleader.
Nice.
And she teams up with Rob the Slasher to kill this one dude. It's pretty cool. And I came up with this completely crazy ending for it. You know, because it's just like the one thing I always try to do is I try to do something different for the ending each time. And this one is no exception. I call it kind of like a visual prank, if you will. You know, give an ending that's so crazy that not one person on the planet Earth could possibly conceive that this was going to happen. And so that's basically what I did with Scream for Christmas. And I promise you, if you're watching the movie, the ending is going to catch you completely by surprise. You're like, what the?
The fuck is wrong with this man? But like, I've seen some of the, I've seen the trailer to Scream for Christmas. Mm-hmm. And it is over the top gore. There's tits galore. It is
well, like actually, there's no nudity in Scream for Christmas. It's the only movie I've done where there's no nudity.
But I've seen
plenty of gore though.
There's plenty of gore. I've seen an eyeball getting pulled out. I've seen a lot of shit happening now, and it seems like a Troma movie. And it's crazy because it makes sense. You're with Troma now. So I mean, what is it like to be able to? I'm pretty sure you're a Troma fan. Growing up, what is it like to be with Troma and working with Lloyd and the guys?
Oh man, with this movie, I didn't really work with them. I just kind of like I made it and then I kind of contracted it to them. But believe it or not, there was a time where I did work with Lloyd Kaufman a long time ago for Toxic Avenger, Citizen Toxie.
That's my favorite one.
I drove all the way from Dayton, Ohio to Poughkeepsie, New York. And I was like, I was there going to be one of the extras in the movie, and I'm actually in the movie for a good 2 seconds. And it was really funny. I would have been in the movie there longer, but I ended up going home early because I had a severe allergic reaction. And I forgot to bring my medication with me, so I felt like a big bonehead. And of course, at the time, I didn't have any type of medical care or whatever, and so didn't think to go to an emergency room or anything. And when I got back, I was pretty sad because I'm pretty sure had I had stayed, I probably would have got like killed by the Toxic Avenger or something.
Oh. That would have been epic.
But that was I actually saw Lloyd Kaufman, and he was directing. And I saw a lot of behind the scenes stuff with that, and man, that was a fun experience. I don't know if they still do that or if they have people invite people to come as extras for the movie. I don't know if they still do that, but they used to have like a little thing on their website where they did that. But anyways, that was fun. That was one of the experiences I'll ever remember. And they were serving like cheese sandwiches in the cafeteria. And it was so cool. I mean, I highly recommend if anyone gets to work for Troma You know, like if they just get to be there on the set or whatever, do it. You know, it's a great learning experience, and it's a team full of professionals, and they know how to have fun, and they're dead serious with their art too. I mean, they're not just goofing around.
I love it. And Trauma Now is an amazing streaming app too. So like, if you love those old trauma movies, even there's some great new movies like yours that are coming out that Trauma is, you know, putting up on their streaming app. Definitely Trauma Now is an amazing app to have.
Yeah, Trauma is one of the few companies that work with independent filmmakers and helping them find an audience.
Mm-hmm. 100%. And now, so what gave you some inspiration for Scream for Christmas? Like, what gave you the idea to come up with this?
My favorite movie of all time is Silent Night of Deadly Night. I love that film.
Great movie.
And like, I watch it every year around Christmas time along with a whole bunch of other Christmas horror movies. I do that. I have like a Christmas horror movie marathon. And then when I started getting on the internet, I found out that I wasn't the only person to do that. Apparently a lot of people have Christmas horror movie marathons. And so it's, I think it's like a time honored tradition amongst horror fans.
Yeah. And it looks amazing. I mean, I can't wait to even check this out. I mean, now a movie that yours I have seen, and that is Slasher's Gone Wild. By the way, that's streaming on Tubi right now for free if you want to check it out. Now, so for people who haven't seen it, tell them a little bit about Slasher's Gone Wild.
Okay, well, Slasher's Gone Wild, Bloodbath. There's a maniac director, Lunatic Rob. I play that character. And he has this movie thing where he's shooting a film, and he has all these actors there, and they're like, oh, great, we're shooting a horror movie. And like, okay, now where are the special effects going to show up? And then he's like, oh, I got your special effect right here. Yeah, he kills the people for real rather than using special effects. And so and that's basically the plot of the film. And then there's a fake movie inside of it. It's basically a snuff film called Slasher's Gone Wild, where they're having a contest, you know, to see who's the best slasher, you know, but it's all ruse, you know, it's just a fake movie invented to kill the actors in the film. And so it's just like, it's pretty funny and it's super gory. You know? It was inspired also a lot by Monty Python, because I used to watch a lot of Monty Python. So inside the movie, there's like little skits and commercials, and it's pretty messed up.
It is a pretty messed up movie. Now, this one, you do get to see a lot of tits and ass in this one.
Tons of
this one, you do get to see a lot of tits and ass. But yeah, I mean, it looks and feels wrong. It feels like a snuff film, like you're watching a snuff film. It just feels wrong.
Yeah, and the it's kind of based off of like when you're on the internet, you know, and you stumble, like, because I used to collect gore pictures because I'm a special effects artist, and that's how I would look at the gore pics and I would try to recreate that with my special effects. And so I wanted them to look as realistic as I could. And sometimes when I was looking for gore pics, I'd see something I did not want to see. And of course, I'm not going to talk about it, but everyone sees that stuff, you know, and it's like, wow. It's like, the funny thing about that is I saw one of my movie clips on there. Someone thought it was real. And really? Someone had my chainsaw killing listed as a cartel murder. And they thought it was real, and they had it posted as a clip on this murder site. And I was impressed, shocked, and I just started laughing. I was like, okay, that's comedy, man. But that's I guess that's a compliment.
I mean, there's a lot of, in that movie, there's a lot of fucking kill scenes. There's a lot of fucking kill scenes. And they're done differently in different ways. So tell me your thought process. Like, how were you sitting there like, how is the most fucking horrible way I can kill people that many times in different ways in a movie?
Well, for one thing, I've seen like just about every horror movie that you can possibly imagine. And I've also read books. I invited Marky to Sod. And, man, that's some twisted stuff. You think of horror movies are messed up, man. Just read one chapter of any book written by DeMarcus this side, and you'll just be like, okay, wow.
Wow.
Horrible stuff. But anyways, it's like when I made the decision to make horror movies, I wanted to kind of be authentic. Like, a lot of the characters from Slashers Gone Wild are based off of actual serial killers. You know, like, it's pretty obvious, you know, with Nursery Rhyme Jack, you know, he's based off of Ed Gein, you know, and there's other ones in there as well. And I don't have time to mention all of them, you know, but, you know, it's like Ed Gein's the most obvious one because, you know, there was an Ed Gein's Christmas, you know, during scene, you know, so. But it was inspired in by a lot of the things that I've seen. And a lot of things that I've experienced, and I wanted to make it a realistic gore experience for people. And so some of the scenes, it's like, I'm like, there's only one scene that I didn't like gore-wise. It's like, man, I could have done better on that one. You know, but I think every special effects artist kind of beats himself up on a particular scene or whatever. But it was still, I was like, I think my favorite scene, my favorite gore effect would have to be the chainsaw murder.
That was a good one. That was definitely a good one. Now, do you do all your own practical effects?
Yes. I do all my own practical effects. And then with some of the makeup effects, like some of the zombie effects like that, I had a special effects crew that helped with the zombie makeup, because otherwise it would take a long time. But the main gore effects, like the bathtub scene, chainsaw scene, all the gore effects, like the really messy ones, that's all me.
Now, have you ever thought to yourself making any of your movies? Like, have you ever had a kill scene that you're like, oh shit, this is too far? or do you just push the envelope like, no, I want to go as far as possible?
Okay, I have a funny story. Okay, it's like there was like two versions of my movie. Okay, there was the first one that was released back in 2006, and it was incomplete, you know, because there was a whole bunch of scenes that are in the script that nobody wanted to shoot. You know, no one wanted to shoot the shower scene. No one wanted to shoot the zombie lesbian scene, you know, and so I was just like, yeah, I don't know where I could find these people. And then everyone was just like, you know what, we're done with this movie, man. We're not going to shoot anymore, and they just left. And so I had to edit together what was left, and it's like, every time I watched a movie, I had this hurt feeling. I was like, man, this is just a tiny little bit of what I had written, all put together rather decently, you know, but, you know, I made it work, but I was so disappointed. And then many years later, you know, I was like, I'm working on the sequel, and then I had some leftover money, and then I was like, wait a second. And plus, I had made a lot more connections, so I now knew people, like the Motor City Dolls and all that stuff, and they didn't mind doing the shower scene, you know, and the zombie lesbian scene and all the other good stuff. And so I got all that stuff put in there, and then I also had a bigger budget for gore. And so now I was able to be even do a more realistic, buy a lot more latex rather than using paper towels or something like that, you know. Mm-hmm. And so I made it work a lot better. And it was a lot more fun. And then I finally was able to take all the scenes that was left out and put them back in the movie. And I finally, after all these years, had a completed film. And I was like, Slash Scun Wild, Bloodbath. And
yes. Then
I released it on Tubi. And I think that was basically it for a bit. And then suddenly it just kind of spread. And now it's on Roku. And now it's on Troma Now. And so I'm pretty happy about it, and it's slowly gathering a nice little audience of people. And just wait till the sequel, man. The sequel's going to be messed up.
I'm gonna ask you about the sequel, but when it comes to the original one, have you gotten any flack from people who have seen that movie and feel like you're disgusting? What the fuck's wrong with you? Any of that?
Oh, all the time. It's like when people there's one people that were interviewing it, and it didn't. it didn't occur to me until like maybe mid through the interview that maybe I would just pour it on a little too thick, you know, because it's like, you know, I watch a lot of wrestling too, you know, and so I kind of had this voice going on because I was a character, and I was just, I did the entire interview like this. And then I was like, my movie's going to mess you up. And I did this crazy laugh and all that stuff. And I think they took me seriously. And I'm thinking, like, I was just like, oh, my God. It's like, I got to watch what I do and how I do interviews and stuff. Because there's some people out there and, you know, and maybe they don't get it, you know. And then I was just like, and I don't want to. Yeah, that gets taken out of context just like that. And like, oh, Lunatic Rob really is killing people. And the police are at my door. And I'm like, end up like, oh, what was it? I forget that. The director of, I think it was Cannibal Holocaust, one of the cannibal movies.
Yes.
They believed that it was real, so they arrested him.
Yes, Hannibal Holocaust. And they
had all the actors pop up and prove Hannibal, they were still alive.
Yep.
That's a compliment and a half, man.
That is a compliment. Wow.
I don't want to experience it, you know, because as a black man, I don't want police story. That's just a time honored tradition, you know. It's like, hey, I'm cool, you know, I'll stay over here.
I told you so during the pre-interview when you popped on the screen, I was like, oh, you're a black guy. I don't know why. I assume. Why? I was like watching this twisted shit. I was like, this is definitely a white guy who made this fucking movie. I was like, oh, this is a black guy. Okay. So, all right. So you're in the works of Slasher Gone Wild 2. So you said it's going to be bigger, badder, gorier.
And in 3D.
And in 3D.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I got most of it shot. I'm about to do the gore scenes, and man, there's gonna be some wicked gore in there. I'm not gonna give away anything, but I've definitely taken the time to figure out things that people have not seen before, and I can't wait to unleash them and in 3D. So I'll take a step and watch the craziness as it happens, because it's going to be insane.
So are you going to be sending a pair of 3D glasses with the DVD?
Oh yeah, I have a whole pack of 3D glasses, and I think I believe Troma now has a section where they have 3D movies too. So if you're a subscriber to Troma now, you'll be able to check that out as well. And if you need to set a pair of 3D glasses, I'll make them available on the website. I probably won't even charge for it. I'll pop them in an envelope and send them to you. Yeah.
Oh sweet.
I got a whole bunch of them. I get them cheap, and so I might as well distribute them. You know, it's cool.
Nice. And so, all right. So, give me one 3D effect that we possibly will see.
Okay. I'll happily
give an exclusive. Give me an exclusive. Yes.
Okay. There's a scene where the zombies are chowing down on some people, right? And so. I basically laid down on the ground with my 3D camera. I said, come at me, guys. And so you get to see you get to be the victim.
Whoa.
You know, so it's like, if you're wearing the 3D glasses, you know, because I'm not a safe director. You know, I made sure that the zombie hands really look like they're coming at you. And so it's like, it's not like one of those 3D movies where the things don't pop out of the screen. These things do pop out of the screen, and you're going to see the 3D works very well.
Nice. And do we have a possible release date? Would this be next year release?
I'm aiming for next year. I'm aiming for next year. Release wise, I'm probably going to say next Halloween.
Perfect. I would love to have you back. I would love to see it and to have you back on. We can talk about that one as well. All right. So as you know, this is a horror channel. So I'm going to ask you three random horror questions. You ready?
Okay. All right.
So since you're on Troma now, what is your favorite Troma movie of all time?
Oh, wow. Okay. Well, it would be movies. Two of my favorite series, the entire Toxic Avenger series, love it. And the Class of Nukem High series. I have all of them, including the new ones. the newer ones that were shot, those two movies, Volumes 1 and 2, it got those too. And, I'll see Sergeant Kabuki Man, of course.
That's my favorite. So Sergeant Kabuki Man is my favorite. And when people look at me like, that's your favorite? I'm like, I love Sergeant Kabuki Man.
And Father's Day, that was, oh man, that
Father's
was
really Day, cool. Classic.
Yeah, I found out about Asteron 6 through Trova, and I was like, that's a cool company. Everything that Asteron 6 has done is like gold. I mean, at least to me, it is. It's like they have yet to make a movie that I have not enjoyed.
Have you seen Surf Nazis?
Surf Nazis, yes, I have.
Most, by the way, I've been saying since I did it, Shannon, I need to do like a review.
Mother's Day is a good one.
I haven't seen Mother's Day yet.
Oh, Mother's Day is one of Troma's best movies. I mean, not just one of Troma's best movies, one of the best horror movies ever made. I put Mother's Day right up there with Texas Chainsaw Massacre.
Really?
Yeah.
I've seen Father's Day. I haven't seen Mother's Day. I'm going to have to check that out.
Yep.
But Troma makes some off-the-wall fucking crazy shit, man. And I remember seeing my first... Toxic Avenger had a cartoon show for kids. It was called The Toxic Crusaders. And I used to watch it every fucking Saturday. I had the figures and everything.
I still have the
figures. You do?
Yeah, I do. Some of them even unopened.
Nice. So, yeah, I had the big nose snot guy. I had Toxie himself. And I had the villain. The main villain. And
Dr. Gilimoff.
Yes. And and I never seen a Toxic Avenger movie at this point. And I remember, I think I told a story before, but like my older sister, she went to the video store. I remember it was the day before Thanksgiving. She went to the video store and she rented Toxic Avenger Part 3. And that was my first trauma movie and my first Toxic Avenger movie.
The and last temptation of Toxie.
Yes. And I was like, what the fuck am I watching? This is not my cartoon.
Nope.
I was like, this is not... Once he started pulling the guy's intestines out and putting the mop through the guy's ears and twisting... I was like, this is not my cartoon.
Oh, yeah. There was a big difference between the movies and the cartoon.
Huge difference.
But it was still... I love them both, though.
And I hear that the new one is amazing.
Yes.
I hear it's amazing.
I mean, they got Peter Dinklage in it, Elijah Kevin Wood.
Kevin Bacon's in it.
Yep. Kevin Bacon's in everything.
Kevin Bacon's in everything right now.
Yeah.
I don't know if he's just doing cash grabs right now, but he's in everything right now.
Yep.
All right. Second question. What is your favorite kill scene out of any horror movie? Favorite kill scene of all time?
Ooh, favorite kill scene... Okay, you want to know something? This is recent. That show Chucky. Oh man, it's like hey, Chucky stepped up the game, man. It's like there was a scene in season 2. It was the very last kill in the movie in series for that season. And there was this priest that exploded.
Really?
It was just like, it was like the explosion just kept happening. They kept replaying it. But that was like one of the, man, that was like one of the most badass special effects. It's like, boom. And then there was another kill on a Chucky series. Oh, goodness. It's escaping me right now. But it was one of the recent kills. It was like such a good kill. Everybody was talking about it. And of course, right now I can't remember it. Oh, man. But, there's like a lot of different things. I could go on for hours of all the different gore effects that I've seen that I've really enjoyed, but that one stands out. Oh wait! All the kills from Street Trash. I mean, that props to the people like Jennifer Aspinall, I believe, was a special effects artist. Man, she is amazing. I mean, the special gore effects in that movie is like untopped. Like even as long as those that was shot, you still watch that movie and the gore effects are still awesome looking. Every single death scene in that movie is just pure beauty.
Mine is probably, it's not the goriest, but it's just artistically it's beautiful. I can't believe I just said that. But Hostel Part 2, which I'm not a huge fan of Hostel 2. I like Hostel 1. It was the nerdy shy girl, and I kind of liked her character. I felt bad for her character.
Yep.
And when they had her tied up, and the woman had a sickles, and she was just slicing her, and the blood was just falling. Like, it was a beautiful kill scene.
That was a good scene.
And I can't believe I just said that. Yeah, but it was a artistic kill.
Yep. I have yet to see Thanksgiving, but man, I'm about to. I keep hearing that it's good. Have you seen it yet?
I feel like I should do a review. Okay, I'm going to tell you my issue with Thanksgiving. I hate the fucking characters. The characters in the movie are absolutely fucking annoying. Like, but when it comes to killer and kills, amazing movie.
Nice. I think that's kind of like the point with horror films, though. I mean, a lot of the characters are usually based off of... I think usually characters are based off of people that actually annoy people in real life. And then it's just like, when you watch horror films, it's kind of cathartic because you see these people get punished, unlike in real life, you know? It's like, and it's like, wow, you know, like that asshole that did the
one movie. I need one person. I need one person to cheer for, though. You know what I mean? Like, when it comes to horror.
That's the slasher. You cheer for the slasher in the movie. The most horror fans
cheer for true. But, I mean, you don't really know. You don't really know anything about the slasher throughout the movie, kind of, pretty much.
Uh-huh.
But, like, and the kills are amazing. Listen, the kills are fucking top-notch. And for the most part, they're practical effects. And it's top-notch. And I'm a huge Eli Roth fan.
Yes.
But one thing about Eli Roth's movies is... My biggest gripe with his movies is you don't care about his characters at all. Like, he puts in some of the most unlikable fucking characters.
Uh-huh.
That, like, and it kind of takes away from the movie.
Uh-huh.
Because, you know, they're shitty people.
Yeah. I think, like I said, I think in his movies, it's like, certain characters are just basically kind of getting their charismatic... Their karmatic rewards, if you will. You know, yes. Like, they're reaping what they sow.
Except for Knock Knock. I felt bad for Keanu Reeves in Knock Knock. I really did.
Well, think about it, though. Had he had never invited those girls into his house, and you know why he invited them in, none of that would have happened.
No. Listen, he was... I'm pretty sure everybody's seen Knock Knock, so I thought I can get this away. Keanu Reeves was being a nice guy. He really was.
Yep.
He was not trying to get any ass from those women. He really wasn't. He kept saying, no, my wife is not home. My wife's not home. And he just felt it was raining and they were out there. And he just felt bad for them. And they drugged them. I mean, like, I don't see how anything he did wrong. And to be honest, it was rape. To be honest,
it was
rape. Like so, but I don't understand how at the end of the movie he's a bad guy where two women pretty much raped him.
Right. I think it's like one of those things where when I was a kid, I was taught about stranger danger. You know, and for me, stranger danger includes two women that show up in the middle of the night, like
two attractive young women. Yeah.
You know, where did they come from? You know, it's like, did they walk down the street like this? Why didn't they stop at someone else's house? Why mine? You know, and it's like, there's other houses out there. They could stop out there as well. I'm going to tell them, I've got a cold. I'm sick. I can't let you in. I'm sorry. Close door. Bye-bye. Click. Go back to watching my horror film.
look, Rob, I'm black, as you know. I do not even answer my fucking... I don't answer... You can ring on my fucking doorbell. You can... I got a ring doorbell now. I don't answer my fucking door unless I'm expecting someone or unless you're wearing a police officer or firefighter outfit or a mailman. I don't answer my door just open... Oops, my door just for anybody. And right. Also, I live in fucking Baltimore of all places. You can't do that shit in Baltimore. Yes, he was dumb for that because I know I wouldn't even open my fucking door.
Yeah.
And I'm definitely not inviting strangers. I don't care. Listen, I don't care how fucking wet you are and car broke down. I'm not letting you in. But
right.
But he was a nice guy. I mean, he was an honorable guy. He was looking out for these two young girls and get the Shinin. But I think, I don't know why Eli Roth made him to seem to be like the bad guy.
Uh-huh.
In that vibe. And I don't think he was the bad guy. I think he was the dumb guy, but I don't think he was the bad guy.
Yep. I think he was getting punished for being stupid.
Yes. 100%. 100%. All right. Last question. You can remake any classic iconic horror movie that has not already been rebooted, which is probably hard as fuck to do. Which one is going to be?
Devil Times 5.
Oh, that's a good one. No one's ever fucking said that. That's a good one.
Yeah, I love that movie. In fact, if you look at the logo of Slasher's Gone Wild, you know, the silhouette logo, yeah, pretty much inspired by the Devil Times 5 logo. Yeah, it's like, yeah, it's one of my all-time favorites. It's like, I watched that movie with my dad when I was much younger. And that was a kill. That was a really cool film. A lot of cool kills.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
not very gory, you know, but it was still cool. You know, mm-hmm. Neat characters. And, you know, it's just like, I was thinking to myself the entire time I was watching it, this movie is excellent. You know, but, and I was just imagining it being just slightly scarier. And I was like, you know, if I ever got a chance to remake that movie, but there's a lot of films like that I've seen, but that's the main one that sticks in my mind because, like I said, that's one of my favorites.
That's a good one. No one's ever said that when I asked that question. All right. Rob, where can everyone find you, my friend?
Oh, I'm worldparody.com.
World Parody. All right, everyone, please go on. Listen, go and subscribe to Troma Now if you're a horror fan. Please do that. It's not even expensive. I think it's like $1.99 a month or something.
That's like $4.99 a month. And on Troma Now, there's like a whole bunch of excellent movies, and you will find hours of entertainment every time you go there.
A little bit of everything on there for you. If you're a horror fan, if you're a trauma fan, the whole library is up. The whole library is up there. No, they were running a special for Black Friday. It was $1.99
mm-hmm.
a month for the whole year, but now it's $4.99. So, but still, not bad price. $4.99 to get.
It's excellent. I mean, excellent deal. But yeah, on my website on worldparody.com, I've got links to all the places where you can find my movies. Amazon, Troma Now, Tubi. And we're also selling t-shirts. We got t-shirts for Slash Gone Wild, Slash Scream for Christmas. And we also got special Christmas shirts made just for the season called Christmas Horror.
Awesome. All right. I'm definitely going to check out some of those shirts, man.
Thank you, man.
All right. Well, listen, it's been a pleasure to have you on, man. Listen, when Slasher Gone Wild 2 comes out, please let me know. I'm going to have you back on. We're going to talk about that motherfucker, too.
Definitely. Thanks for having me on the show, man. This is a cool experience.
Thank you, brother. I appreciate you coming on. And everybody, thank you for coming to the Horror Room. I'm Travis Bruce. Please hit that like and subscribe button. It helps me out a lot. All right, guys. You take care.
Peace.